morning. I love Sunday mornings with you. Gathering together to worship Christ together, I'm telling you, it is the highlight of my week. I'm so glad to be here, and let's just keep in that posture of leaning into the Lord, because I really believe he has a word for us today. And so what I'd love for you to do is turn over to Acts chapter 3, and as you're going there, I want you to think with me for a moment. Don't you like it when things are the way they were made to be? Like new socks. Yeah, putting on new socks doesn't get much better than that. Or how about when Pastor Jeff's TV sinks and works? Or when your car drives the way it's supposed to? Or when your cell phone connects to Wi-Fi? Or when friends you enjoy being together? Or when the baby goes to sleep like it's supposed to? Life is good when things are the way they were meant to be. But as is life, socks get worn out, and somehow, I still haven't figured out, they get eaten by the dryer. I don't know. Devices and Wi-Fi get cranky. Jeff's TV doesn't sync. Bodies get worn out. Friendships get prickly, and babies, well, they just act their age. And for the last 2 weeks, we've learned about the signs, 10 of them, of a healthy church. They're going to be back up on the screen. That is the way church is designed to be. People who love the Bible. People who are committed to prayer. People who gather together. People who go out to reach the lost. Consider these last 2 weeks as sort of a recalibration of who we are. Because sometimes, church, we could use a little refocus. Have you heard about those videos on YouTube that are just the thing right now? These popular, trending videos. They're video diaries of people's daily lives. They're simply referred to as a day in the life. Click play and just watch the person go through their day. And as you watch, you get a sense of who they are. And the more you get to know who they are, you get a sense then of why they do what they do. And as a church, we've actually been doing something kind of similar as we've been going through the book of Acts. Like those video diaries, God's word is giving us an insight into who the early church was. That's what we've learned the last 2 weeks. And today we're going to look at a passage, again, we're in Acts chapter 3, that's going to help us to see that because of who they were, here's what they did. And that's why the title to today's message is A Day in the Life. And here's why we're doing this. The call of the church then is the call of the church now. We're all witnesses. And as we'll learn today, we're witnesses who go to lost people, give what they have, and glorify God always. So let's pick up in Acts chapter 3. We're going to read verses 1 through 10. Now, Peter and John were going up to the temple at the hour of prayer, the ninth hour. And a man lame from birth was being carried, whom they laid daily at the beautiful gate. Let me say that again. Whom they laid daily at the gate of the temple that is called the beautiful gate, to ask alms of those entering the temple. Seeing Peter and John about to go into the temple, he asked to receive alms. And Peter directed his gaze at him, as did John, and said, "Look at us." And he fixed his attention on them, expecting to receive something from them. But Peter said, "I have no silver and gold, but what I do have I give to you. in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk. And he took him by the right hand and raised him up, and immediately his feet and ankles were made strong. And leaping up, he stood and began to walk and entered the temple with them, walking and leaping and praising God. And all the people saw him walking and praising God and recognized him as the one who sat at the beautiful gate of the temple asking for alms. And they were filled with wonder and amazement at what had happened to him. Let's start with this first point from verses 1 and 2. Witnesses go to the lost people. Peter and John, they've gone out in twos. They've gone to the temple at the ninth hour of prayer, which means about 3 p.m. And these daily prayer sessions were no casual thing. Inspired by a passage in Exodus chapter 29, these devout Jews were practicing morning and evening sacrifices, and over time, a time of prayer was woven into these sacrificial moments. To devout Jews, these were fundamental times to gather with the Lord. Part of what made these prayer times significant also was where they took place. Check out this picture of the temple. As you can tell, that meant big crowds, which makes me wonder, why did Peter and John go to the temple? Was it because they wanted to be with the in crowd? Or was it because they were having a hard time letting go of maybe some of their Jewish heritage and they were thinking, well, I've got Jesus, and how about I season it with a little good works? I'm so glad to be able to tell you that is not the case. They didn't go for popularity or religious reasons. No, no, no. Nowhere in Acts do we see ever the apostles going to the temple to offer sacrifices for their sin. They knew they didn't need to. They believed what the writer of Hebrews said, which says, under the old covenant, the priest stands and ministers before the altar day after day, offering the same sacrifices again and again. Can never take away sins, but our high priest offered himself to God as a single sacrifice for sins, good for all times. And when sins have been forgiven, there is no need to offer any more sacrifices. It is finished. So, if the apostles didn't go to the temple for being popular or to get more right with God, that could only mean they went to the temple because Acts chapter 1, verse 8 was boiling in their souls. Remember Acts chapter 1, verse 8? But you will receive power, Jesus said, when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem. That's a clear call. And with it comes a confident promise. And that fueled in these men a burning vision to go to their fellow Israelites, to tell them, Messiah Jesus, he's here. He came. It's kind of like when a soldier ignores his own safety to run through gunfire to rescue a fallen brother. That's how Peter and John went to the temple with that mindset. I'm going, we're going, no matter what it means for us. And then at the same time that they're going to the temple, a man, lame, is laid before the beautiful gate. Let's see that picture of the temple again. And I can imagine it's that gold door that you see at the very front. Historians think that's probably the beautiful gate. So somewhere around there, this lame man has been laid down by his friends like each day prior, according to Acts 4:22, for probably the last 40 years. So I want you for a moment to put yourself in this man's life. Day after day, dependent, desperate, that someone would show up again like they did yesterday to carry him out into the public square so that he can beg again just to survive. That's why this man is at the beautiful gate. He's smart. Like the guys who play the bucket drums outside the stadium after a concert or a game, this guy knows that this is prime time to make some money. But not only is he there because the crowd is going to be big, but he knows that a devout Jew would probably want to do a little bit of good, like dropping a few coins on a guy's mat as they walk into the temple, because that's going to help their prayers out a little bit, right? Doing a little good. And then within that, mixed in with all the people flocking to the temple, you got Peter and John, willing to go to witness. Their willingness reminds me of some people known as the greatest generation. It was those people who lived during the World War II era, a time when men wept at being turned away from being able to serve their country, who felt deep shame at not being able to sacrifice their lives for others. But what happens when we swipe right a few years? We get the counterculture, the me generation, self-actualization. And since then, what's happened? Staggering increases in technology. And so I'm wondering, what do you think? Has that helped or hurt our attempt to focus maybe a little less on us? I think it's only helped us to focus more on ourselves, really. And so how then does our church, our campus, how do I counter this culture of individualism? And you know what? I need to be honest. I have to ask that kind of question because I really struggle with this. I mean, what does it mean to go to the lost? Does it mean that I need to walk the streets of my neighborhood every night and knock on doors and we need to tell all of the people we work with about Jesus? But what if I miss a day? What if I missed a week? Did I mess up? Isn't it interesting how we live in these extremes? And I don't think that God intends for us to live in either of those, but here instead. And so I wonder, is it possible that somewhere in those 10 marks of a healthy church, there might be a help for us in figuring out how we can go to the lost? And I'm going to suggest that there are two for sure. Number one is that we're fueled by a commitment to the Bible. And number two, right there with it, is that we're committed to prayer. And so imagine, what do you think is going to happen this week when we pray that God would give us the heart that we see that he has in the Bible for the lost? Like this. God, in Mark 10:45, it says that you came not to be served, but to serve and to give your life. Help me, God. I've been adopted into your family not to be served, but to serve and to give my life for others. And if that means at the expense of my time, my reputation, my comfort, well, God, would you give me the courage to do that? Or Jesus, in the Gospels, it says that you left heaven knowing that you would be rejected by your people. God, I do not have the capacity to love people like that, but I want to. Oh, Lord, would you give me a heart like yours for the people in my life? One more. Lord, in Luke 19, it says that you wept over Jerusalem. Help me, Jesus, to have a heart that breaks like yours does over the people in my life that don't yet know you. We need to do this. We need to do this because there are forces of all kinds that are warring for our family and our friends. The parents that are on the sidelines or on the school committees, our colleagues and our classmates. And those forces will expense nothing to snatch them from the Lord. But we have a power against which nothing can prosper. The sword of the Spirit and the power of prayer. And I don't mean to be overdramatic, but in a way I do. Because the reality is, these people that you are thinking of right now who are not walking with Christ as we are privileged to, their eternities are at stake. So what can we do? That leads to the next thought. Picking up in verse 3, witnesses give what they have. There's no indication that the apostles knew this man. But if Peter and John had gone to the temple with any kind of frequency, they had surely seen this man before. Kind of like when you would ride the train. Some of you would ride the train to work down in Chicago, the same train one day after another, and without fail, you're going to see the same people as you're on the train, the same people as you're walking to work. You're going to see the same train conductor on the train. You're going to see the same guy playing the guitar on the street corner. And in the midst of this rush of people going to the temple, Peter and John, what happens? Nudged by the Spirit, they stop. But this isn't some rolling stop, drop a few coins and keep going into the temple. Mm-mm. No. They stop to do with this man what I would imagine hasn't happened since he was maybe held in his mother's arms as a child. They stop and they look at him. I wonder what this man's thinking as Peter and John are stopping to look at him. I know what he's thinking. Show me the money, man. Let's go. These guys are gonna give me something. But this is the day that something much better would happen. Now, why doesn't Peter offer this man any silver or gold? Well, maybe it was because these new followers of Jesus were beginning to share everything together. Probably. But more than that, I think it's because Peter knew he had something priceless to offer to him. Just think about what Peter's experienced in the last few weeks. A resurrection, an ascension, tongues of fire, miraculous conversions, healings, and more. I mean, is it any wonder that he's ready to offer to this man Jesus? And notice how he does it. He says, in the name of Jesus Christ. And I want to be really clear. This isn't some magical, like, hocus pocus. Here's how one commentator put it. In Acts, when used by the apostles, Jesus' name carries the sense of power and authorization. You see, what's happening is that through the apostles, Jesus is continuing his healing ministry. And I noticed something interesting. Peter says, in the name of Jesus Christ of what? What does it say in the text? Nazareth. Hold on. Doesn't Peter know that there are bumper stickers and t-shirts that say nothing good comes out of Nazareth? Now, this is just my thought, but I wonder if Peter said of Nazareth because he wants to make sure that this guy and anyone who's watching knows that Jesus is for everyone. And I'm not sure, again, I'm not sure that that's why Peter said it, but nonetheless, aren't you glad that's true? Now notice what happens next. Picking up in verse 7. Two arms extended. One reaching up. The lame man. I wonder, was it the grace in Peter's gaze? Was it the confidence in his words? You see, the passage there, he doesn't give any indication that the man hesitated to extend his hand toward Peter. That's the hand extending up, and now Peter's hand extending now. What does it say? It says he took him, which really means that he took his hand with force. I wonder, was Peter remembering what Jesus promised that, hey, you're going to be able to do greater things? And then something extraordinary happens. The man's feet become strong. One writer says about Dr. Luke that the words that he used here actually signifies that the man's ankle snapped back into place. Wow, right? But before we go any further, I want to just, can we pull into the rest stop for a minute to talk about what this passage means then and now for us? First, do we think that this miracle really happened? Everybody go like this. Yes, absolutely. Why? Because of the reliability of God's word. I believe, our church believes, this miracle happened without a doubt. And speaking of God's word, I want to share with you two verses on the screen that are going to speak to the purpose, the why behind these miracles. The first is in John 25. Jesus said, I told you, and you do not believe the works that I do in my Father's name. What do? These miracles. They bear witness about Jesus. And then in Acts, this is about Paul and Barnabas. It says in Acts 14:3, so they remained for a long time, speaking boldly for the Lord, who bore witness to the Lord of his grace, granting signs and wonders to be done by their hands. You see, the early church didn't have the Bible like we do. We can read the Bible and have our faith strengthened by reading these stories of God at work. And so the primary purpose of these miracles was to prove that the gospel was true, that the apostles were truly God's messengers, and finally, these miracles were used to establish the church. Okay, so bottom line, are miracles still possible? Sure. The God of today is the same God that we read of in the Bible. And in fact, our church has a scrapbook full of stories of miracles. But as Pastor Tommy taught us a few weeks ago, on-demand miracles, like the ones that we're reading about today, are, here it is, descriptive, not prescriptive. All right. Let's hop back in and keep going, okay? So this idea of witnesses who give what they have reminds me of a hero, Dietrich Bonhoeffer. Bonhoeffer was a young adult at the same time that Adolf Hitler was rising to power and preparing Germany to go to war. And at the same time that Hitler was doing that, Bonhoeffer, He too started a movement, an underground movement that was all about spiritual formation, helping people to grow more passionate for Jesus Christ. And then one day, an old friend from the upper class neighborhood that Bonhoeffer had grown up in came to visit Dietrich and to say, hey, bro, like, chill. You're just a little too fired up about Jesus, man. You're embarrassing yourself. Dial it down. So Bonhoeffer said, come on. And they went on a little walk. He took his friend to a hill that overlooked an airfield where Nazi troops were marching and planes were taking off and landing. And he turned to his friend and he said, if the Third Reich is giving all that it has, its resources, its discipline, to do evil, then how much more should the thing he was doing, helping form in Christians Christ's mind, Christ's heart, Christ's mission, how much more does his thing need to be stronger than that thing? And it's not much different for us today, is it? The war for people's souls is on full tilt. And our church, our campus, has the opportunity responsibility to be witnesses like Bonhoeffer who give what we have so that the world may know Jesus. And here are two ways that you can start to live that out today. Whatever the spiritual gift is that the Holy Spirit has given to you, steward them. 1 Peter 4:10 says, as each has received a gift, you know Christ, you've received a spiritual gift. Use it and use it to serve one another as good stewards of God's varied grace. God is anticipating that you're going to use the spiritual gifts that he has given to you, like Peter and John did, to help build his church to shine bright in a darkening world. You can discover your gift today, if you're not sure what it is, by going to a website. On our website, it's harvestbiblechapel.org/discover-my-gift. It's not a perfect process, but every time I do it, I go, that's me. I would encourage you to do that. But here's the thing. You could have whatever gift God has chosen for you, but if you don't have one really important thing, that's going to be a problem. We'll see that in 1 Corinthians 13:2. If I have prophetic powers and understand all mysteries and all knowledge and I have all faith as to move mountains, but what? But not love, I'm nothing. What was it really, I wonder, that stopped Peter and John? Yes, the Holy Spirit. He gets the prize, no doubt. But I believe the Spirit moved in them a heart of love for that lame man that moved them to stop and to look at him. And so what about you? When you look at the people in your life who are not following Christ, who do you see? Do you see someone who could be a glorious artwork for God? Do you see someone who's being dominated by the something of the world and you are privileged to hold the keys to freedom? You know, nowadays, people pay folks to listen to them. People need something. And you're in someone's life because they need something, and you have what they need. And yeah, while you may not be able to meet all of their needs, here's what you can do, starting with what Peter and John did. See people. See the people that God has in your life the way he does. Listen to them. Cry with them. Pray with them. Share your story with them. Tell them the good news. Give what you can. And when you do, you'll be pointing them to the Savior. And when you do that, you'll see happen what takes place next in our passage, picking up in verse 8. And leaping up, he stood and began to walk, entered the temple with them, walking and leaping and praising God. What do witnesses do? Last point, they glorify God always. What caught my attention is that this man, he leapt up. And now I don't know if he literally sprang to his feet or if he just raced up quickly, but I just love the thought of this man going from his confinement to the ground to now he's leaping and he's jumping and he's shouting. And then with the apostles, the man burst through the beautiful gate that up to this point was like a giant billboard that had said to him, "Stay out, not welcome." But he burst through that gate and he's shouting praises to God, and his praises can be heard throughout the courts. This man is now a witness because he's glorifying God. And notice that the text says, as it goes on to verses 9 and 10, that his praise was widespread. Word was traveling fast. The man who moments ago was lame is now walking and leaping and jumping and praising. The impact of all who saw and heard. People were filled with wonder and amazement. And so I'm wondering, was this guy just healed physically, or was he saved? Well, I can presume that because of what we read about when Jesus did his miracles, this in the same way, when people were healed by Jesus, it's followed up with forgiven. So combine that with what you'll read in the coming days in Acts 3:16, I think it's safe to say this man is a brother. And then what about the crowd of people? Well, what we know from today's passage is that this miracle did what it was intended to. It arrested people's attention away from the monotony and the powerlessness of the Jewish sacrificial system. And what we're going to see next week is Peter seizing the opportunity to proclaim the gospel to a captive audience, helping to connect the dots between what they're seeing and prophecy, messianic prophecy like the one in Isaiah 35:6 that says, "Then shall the lame leap like a deer." Awesome. The outcome of this man's witnessing to a captive audience, spoiler warning, can you handle it? The impact is gonna be epic. This week, my check engine light came on. When I got the report back from my mechanic, it was an apocalypse. $4,000 worth of repair. Can anyone say second opinion? Yeah. So when I took it to the mechanic that I should have gone to first, within minutes, he was like, "Oh yeah, easy fix. Car drives great." And I saved thousands of dollars. And I was leaping for joy. I raced home and jumped on the web and wrote the most glorious review about this guy. I am now a witness for this mechanic. So let's bring it home. How would you describe your enthusiasm for Jesus? Are you glorifying God always for how he's worked in your life, or is Jesus more or less just kind of a Sunday thing? Regardless of where you are on that scale, here's how you can stoke the fire for Christ. Stay close to the mat. Stay close to the mat. We need to remember that each of us are walking miracles. You see, if you know Christ, you are heading to a Christless eternity. But God, through the gift of faith and repentance, has adopted you into his family. And now, our aim is to make much of him. We're witnesses. That's my story. And if you know Christ, it's your story. And let's be honest, as a church our size, it's kind of easy to fall into cruise control. So we need to fight against this temptation to get casual in our walk with Jesus. And so we can do that by reflecting on our story, by remembering the gospel. And here's one more. No charge for this one. Grow more in love with God. We get excited about the things that we love. And so if you want to be a God who glorifies God always, pursue a deeper love for God. We like things the way they were made to be, don't we? But what this text and what a lot of life is teaching us is that God, he loves to use our brokenness to do great things that make much of him. And it reminds me of something that I learned as I close here. I want to share with you something that I learned here recently. I'm not a real big art guy, but I thought this was kind of cool. There's this Japanese art called kintsugi. You can see on the screen what it looks like. It's when an artist takes broken pieces of pottery and rejoins them using a lacquer that has within it beautiful gold powder. That word kintsugi literally means to join with gold. And what makes this art so unique is it actually emphasizes the broken pieces rather than trying to hide or disguise them. And God has done the same kind of work in you if you know Christ. Each of us has parts of us that have been chipped or broken or even shattered. And here's the thing. God loves using broken vessels sealed with his beautiful grace to pour out good news to people who need the Lord. So we know who we are. There's 10 marks of them. And now we have a better sense of what we do. Witnesses who go to lost people, give what we have, and glorify God always. And here's what I want us to remember. A day in the life of the early church can be a day in our lives too. I'm going to pray, and then we're going to worship. We've had quite a morning, right? 9 baptisms. Amazing worship. Some tough news. So what better thing than to just stay in this place with the Lord? God, we love you. Thank you for your mercy. You're in our midst, quieting us with your love. You're rejoicing over us. Your word says so. And God, we want nothing more than to rejoice over you. Receive our praise. In Jesus' name I pray.